Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon, and welcome to what I think must be the, yes, the fifth in my series of lectures called The Christian Singer from the Gospels to the Gothic Cathedrals. You should all have a handout with some pictures on, and I hope you'll forgive me that the back of the handout, so to speak, is the cover picture of a book that I wrote, but it's 5 years ago that it was published, so it is in no sense have these lectures been a sustained publicity campaign for the book. But if you find anything in these lectures of interest, and wonderfully it may seem that you do, because as I say every time at this point, I recognize many faces, now friends in this audience, so thank you for coming back, and if these materials do interest you, well, you will find more there, of course, in the book published by Yale University Press and in much greater detail. But as I say, it's 5 years ago, so I'm innocent of any determination to plug the book. Before we go any further, I'd like to introduce to you the singer who's going to sing for us this afternoon. Ladies and gentlemen, Greg Skidmore. Let me just recap a little. This might seem the moment to do that, I think. I began the lectures with the music of the first Christians, moved on to the beginnings of a ministry of singing, that was in lecture two, then turned to the schooling of such singers in cathedrals, that was the third. In the most recent lecture a few weeks ago, I considered Rome, if you remember, and we heard some Roman chant. But now, for the fifth and penultimate lecture, there's a curious gap from now until May, when I hope you'll return. My subject today is what is perhaps the destination of the whole journey that we've been taking together. Gregorian chant. So we begin with an example of it, the chant Factus Est Repente. Now, this is a chant for Pentecost Sunday. And you have it in a modern version of genuinely medieval notation at the top of your handout. And the text says, "And suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind in the place where they were sitting. Alleluia."
Factus est repente, de celo solus adveni.
Now, the first page of the handout I gave you also shows the beginning of that particular chant taken from a manuscript of the 10th century. That's the late 10th century. That's the color illustration you see. It was copied before the invention of the staff that we still use. So what you can see are the delicate pen strokes, the neumes, that sketch. That, I think, is the right word. It's writing this kind of notation is really a form of drawing that sketch the outline of the melody, reminding, but not actually telling, the singer how it rises and falls, and showing how the elements of the melody are parceled out to the different syllables of the text. It's actually a very flexible and good system if all you need is a reminder or an authoritative record to keep in the library. Now, as I've said several times in the course of what I've had to say to you, The preferred term for Gregorian chant amongst those who study it now is not Gregorian chant, but Frankish-Roman chant. It's widely agreed that the music began to emerge sometime after 750. I'm going to explain why as we go on, and that it was produced by a complex interaction, perhaps over many years, between the plain song of Rome and the music sung in the most powerful kingdom of Northern Europe in the early Middle Ages, the kingdom of the Franks. Now, the Franks obviously have given their name to France, and the story of how they emerged from the transformation of the Roman world to become rulers of what is now France and Germany together gives shape, I think, to the history of the early Middle Ages. It's one of the great themes of early medieval history, of how that happened. And I'd suggest to you that their kingdom is still with us. In territorial terms, what is the Franco-German motor of the European Union, if not the domain of the Franks? The organization now known as the European Union was founded in 1957, under a different name, as you know, comprising Belgium, France, Germany, Italy, Luxembourg, and the Netherlands, nations whose lands map out with unnerving fidelity the empire of the greatest Frankish ruler of all, Charlemagne. Well, how did this Gregorian or Frankish-Roman music that you just heard come into existence, and why should we care, really? There are more pressing things you might think to consider. Well, my answer would be is that in thinking about that music, I think you know, if you've been following me these months, I think you know what my answer is. It is that we are looking into the origins of our Western music. How wide should the compass of a vocal melody be before it ceases to lie comfortably in the voice? How long should a musical phrase last before there's a pause for breath? How should the arrival of that pause be signaled in the melody according to different pauses of different weight as the music goes past the ear? Well, Gregorian plainsong offered persuasive answers to all of those questions, and composers absorbed them until the Reformation and in many places long after. Now look again at the medieval musical notation on your handout. That's the color panel from that 10th century manuscript. It comes from a very different civilization, obviously. In many ways violent and primitive, albeit driven by high ideals. But despite the wind of so many centuries sounding in our ears, despite the fact that the manuscript comes to us from a world of stone abbeys, shrunken Roman cities, and stockade forts, it seems to me, and perhaps to you, that the music it records is often wonderfully intelligible. In the chant we just heard, the one recorded in that manuscript, the text announces the great mystery of Pentecost and the miracle that began the apostles' task of taking the Christian message out into the world. Listen how dramatically the melody announces that miraculous event and the sudden wind from heaven with an almost fanfare-like repetition of the interval of a fifth.
Factus est repente.
Perhaps we could just have that again.
Factus est repente.
It's absolutely clear from that what the musical territory of the chant, so to speak, is going to be. And then a sound, a sonus, comes from heaven. And listen how the music decorates that word sonus, carrying it up to the peak of the melody.
De cielo sonus.
Perhaps again.
De cielo sonus.
And now I'll ask Greg to put it all together and sing you Factus est repente one more time.
Factus est repente. De cielo sonus adveniendi spiritus vehementis ubi est. pletis sunt omne spiritus sancto loquentes manialia Dei. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Greg, as I'm sure you can tell, is a very experienced singer of this music, and I think he would agree with me that it is superbly well designed so that the singer can take a breath where a breath is required in a moment that makes musical sense. And I don't know whether you felt that listening to it, and there are more examples of that music to come, but the kind of thing, the melody, kind of things it does are simply intelligible. There are surprises, and it would be a less interesting repertoire if there weren't. But the way it settles on a particular core pitch, moves away from it, then returns to it, is remarkably intelligible to us now, and there's a reason for that, and that is, of course, that it lies at the very deepest roots of the music we inherit. It seems to me it is music that is very wise in its use of the voice. Well, how did it emerge? Well, in the last lecture, as you may remember, I described a pope making a journey. He went in a cavalcade through the streets of Rome to the great church where he was due to celebrate Mass. Well, today we follow another pope as he moves from place to place, but this time the setting is very different. It's the Alpine passes in the depth of a white and frozen winter. This is in every way a historic moment. The year is late in 753. And this is the first time that a pope, a vicar of St. Peter, has ever come onto the North European plain. It's a great moment, you might think, in those grasslands of the north, reconnecting with the Italian Mediterranean, remaking a kind of Europe after the fracture of that with the end of the Roman world. For that is the pope's destination, the grasslands of what's now Champagne in northern France. It is, as you might expect, a political journey, though that word ignores the great spiritual consequence of what was taking place and the direct involvement, as we'll soon see, of a very distinguished citizen of heaven. For a considerable time now, Rome has been the western extreme of the surviving Eastern Roman Empire, Byzantium, if you prefer. But this pope, who's making this journey in winter through the Alpine passes, he must be desperate. Stephen II, he wishes to align Rome with a Latin West, partly because he feels he has no choice. The Byzantines, that is the surviving Eastern Romans in the Eastern Roman Empire, are preoccupied in their conflict with Arabs, who, of course, at the time we're speaking of, have recently been energized by their prophet, by Slavs and Avars, among others, and are therefore increasingly unable or unwilling to ensure the welfare and security of their imperial subjects in Rome. Now, earlier popes had showed themselves ready to patch up alliances wherever they could make them, but in this year of 753, Pope Stephen has decided to follow a policy that's been in the minds of the popes for at least 100 years. He will turn to the most powerful people on the grasslands of the north, the Franks. So the pope came to what is now a bleak and rather desolate hamlet of Champagne, not far from the town of Vitry-le-François, and a place called Pontion. This place is so small that when I stayed in a hotel in Vitry-le-François and the morning after spending my first night there, asked the concierge to get me a cab to Pontion. He had no idea where it was. In fact, it's only 2 miles away. That's how small it is now. But at the time we're talking about, it was the site of a great Frankish royal villa or palace farm. And there is still a rusting sign, metal sign, by the field today to show where it stood. The Frankish king whom the pope met bore the name of Pippin, a great name among the Franks, and he was the third of his line to bear it. Excuse me. I beg your pardon. Pippin brought with him to the meeting a young lad of 6 or 7, his son, called Charles. That is the future Charlemagne. Pippin, incidentally, couldn't write, and the first page of your handout shows him making his mark. The very bottom item of that page, in the rather wayward spelling of the Frankish scribes at that time, says signum, then a cross, put there by Pippin himself, in lustris Pipino majordomus. It's not terribly good Latin, but it says, of course, the sign of the most illustrious Pippin, mayor of the palace, which was the rank he held at the time this particular charter was witnessed by him. He couldn't write. Excuse me. So picture the scene. The king and the pope meet in the chapel of the villa in what must have been, by the standards of the time, a very intimate meeting. The pope is accompanied by only 2 deacons, a couple of presbyters, and no more. According to one account, he and his clergy lay prostrate on the floor. The pope having ash upon his head as a sign of penitential wretchedness, and wearing a shift of linen. Again, a penitential gesture. This is what Pippin saw when he walked into his villa chapel. The pope spread-eagled on the ground in penitential pose. And the pope refused to rise, at least according to the Franks who were present, until Pippin and several other Franks picked him up, physically picked him up, so that he could stand. The fact that this was all happening in a palace farm to the braying of bullocks or the lowing of cows shouldn't obscure the fundamental thing that was going forward, something between a national synod of the Frankish Church, a council of the king with his most intimate nobles, and a papal piece of papal imperial diplomacy at the highest level. Well, if the Pope rose from his prostration to address that illiterate King Pippin in the style of letters he had sent him, then Pippin and his family heard a passionate speech ranging from the abjection of Israel in Egypt to the anger of Christ in judgment. At times, the Franks may even have sensed the sharp smell of the pit, because the Pope was not reluctant to predict the consequences should they fail to act on St. Peter's behalf. And here's an extract from one of the letters that Pippin received. Do not harden your ears against us, nor turn your face away from us, lest we be confounded in our petition, and lest we be tested to the end. So may the Lord also not harden his ear to your entreaties, and turn not away his face from you in that day of judgment to come, when, with St. Peter and his other apostles, he will sit to judge every rank, both sexes and every human power and the world through fire, so that it be not said to you, I do not know you, because you did not come to the aid of the church and did not take charge of his chosen people when sorely tried. Coming from St. Peter's representative on earth, this exalted righteousness with its explicit warning, you might say threat, must have given, I think, a fearfully transcendent character, a very strange atmosphere to that meeting in the villa. Indeed, the Pope was quite prepared to make the Franks feel the presence of St. Peter, that citizen of heaven I mentioned a moment ago, with some intensity, to judge by another letter that he sent them, which, as far as I know, is virtually without parallel among medieval documents, where epistolary convention directed the Franks to look for the name of the sender, rather than, of course, the recipient, of the sender. There was written, Petrus Vocatus Apostolus, Peter called the Apostle. This was a letter not from St. Peter's representative on earth, but from St. Peter. The Pope arrived at the villa on the 6th of January 754, the Feast of Epiphany, when the Church celebrates, of course, as you know, the first showing of Christ to the Gentiles in the form of the Magi. So I think this is a moment to hear an Epiphany chant, the gradual Omnes de Saba, All those from Sheba will come, bringing gold and frankincense, and showing forth praise to the Lord. Arise and shine out, O Jerusalem, for the glory of the Lord is rising upon you. Did the Pope bring Roman singers with him across the Alps? Well, the Roman documents generated by this remarkable winter embassy that I'm discussing with you don't say so. But then they don't consider anybody below the level of the top priests and the highest dignitaries who made the journey. They're not interested in seeing anyone as lowly as singers. But we would expect the Pope to have been accompanied by some members of the Roman choir, because there were many masses to be celebrated on a journey expected to run for at least 500 kilometers through the Advent season to Christmas and perhaps beyond. Well, our best advice here comes from a Frankish monk called Walafrid Strabo, and he has a good claim, I think, to be giving us the Carolingian family's own version of events, because he became a tutor to Charlemagne's grandson, Charles the Bald. And according to his version, which is very lucid and clear, and I quote, "The more perfect knowledge of chanting, which now virtually all the Franks love, was brought by Pope Stephen at Pippin's request through his clergy when he came to the Franks, in the first place to Pippin, the father of Charlemagne, to seek justice for St. Peter." End of quote, of course. Well, if the more perfect knowledge of chanting came with Pope Stephen from Rome in 754, there must have been Roman singers to bring it. And what's more, rumors hung about the countryside, in the words of Matthew Arnold, in a completely different context, that the Pope had indeed come with singers. Here's a Lombard chronicle, a very obscure figure, but an interesting one, called Andreas of Bergamo, writing about the year 880. And this is what he says. "At this time, the Roman Church was governed by Pope Leo, who suffered much oppression from the Lombards. Leaving his own see, he sought the Franks with many who were most learned in the art of letters, especially singers, who, remaining there at Metz for 3 years," Metz, the cathedral, is the Carolingian family's royal mausoleum, "who, remaining there at Metz for 3 years, did work of such refinement that to this day throughout Francia and Italy, one may say throughout many cities, they resound as an ornament of the church." Well, an undergraduate who wrote that would be sent home in disgrace. Virtually every detail is wrong. Pope Leo has supplanted the pope who actually went, Stephen II, and Charlemagne, who of course is immensely famous, has replaced his father, Pippin, who frankly isn't. But Andreas, you can see, did believe that that meeting I described for you in 754 was of great significance because the pope came with a team of Roman singers, or as he puts it, taking, I think, a rather handsome view of the singers involved, many who were most learned in the art of letters, especially singers. So what did our illiterate King Pippin think he was doing when he put his mark to the various documents generated by his unprecedented meeting with the Pope and with which the rise of Frankish-Roman chant, Gregorian chant, is obviously connected? What did he think he was doing? Well, in a sense, nothing very special. A king was always responsible for protecting and enhancing the church in his realm. It's part of the job description of being an early medieval king. But if there is much in his undertaking that seems to follow a similar pattern, the sense that somehow things are being touched with gold leaf, so to speak, remains strong. In 754, at that meeting, and subsequently, Pippin and Pope Stephen formed what a Roman document calls treaties of peace, pacis federa, a negotiated settlement where the plural treaties draws the sense away, I think, from the written document that you and I would associate with the term treaty towards undertakings given by word of mouth and with good faith, fides, that mattered most to contemporaries. As you can imagine, in this age, face-to-face contact matters immensely. There are no long-distance forms of communication except that can be is provided by the muscles of horses. People want to do things face-to-face in ways that cross the boundary, perhaps, between what you and I think of as friendship and alliance. They are very coloured. One colours the other. Now, for an early medieval king like Pippin, the task of preserving peace obviously meant preserving the kingdom from external threat. But peace, I think, in this period doesn't mean what it means to you and me, which is mostly, I think, a highly desirable condition of freedom from war, regarded as a political and humanitarian disaster for everyone involved. An early medieval king like Pippin thrives on war. The way in which he keeps his followers loyal to him, or many of which come from families who think of themselves quite as distinguished as the Carolingian family, the way he keeps them bound to him is by taking them on expeditions, on what we might think of as raids or wars into neighboring territory, capturing slaves, capturing cattle, capturing horses, coming back, enduring the winter, and then setting off to do the same thing again. So he's not a pacific king. No early medieval king is. But peace means good social order, certainly. But it means especially those bound by the same doctrine, the same Christian doctrine, and existing in the state described by St. Augustine, where, and I quote, they do not ponder schismatic thoughts, for there is peace between them. But to share a doctrine, to believe, for example, that Christ was not created by God the Father, despite the term Father, but had been there right from the beginning, something which Catholics and Anglicans assert every day when they go to Evensong and say, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be. I mean, that is a point of doctrine which some heretics denied. So to share a doctrine was important, but to share a rite and its music, that was another matter. That was a divergence that was allowed, but that's not to say it was tolerated. Such discrepancies of the way you worshipped and the chant you used were sometimes regarded as cracks in the surface of ecclesiastical and political life. It's very hard to distinguish those two at this time, that allowed the weeds of heresy and schism to grow up and gave enemies and malcontents a reason to think that conflict might spring forth. So let us hear Charlemagne himself. In a book he issued in the year 792, looking back upon the events of 754 when his illiterate father met a pope. The church in our parts has never retreated from the holy and worshipful communion of Rome during the passage of years. Since this church has stood with Rome in the unity of holy faith and has only sundered from it slightly and in a matter which is not dangerous to true belief in the celebration of the liturgy, by the solicitude and labor of our father, King Pippin, of honorable memory, and by the coming into Gaul of the most reverent and holy man, Stephen, prelate of the city of Rome, we have also been joined to Rome in the order of chanting, so that there should be no discrepancy in that order between churches which share an identity of belief. Well, for Charlemagne, it seems that unity of rite and chanting with Rome is a means to show exceptional friendship, part of the treaties of peace. And it's a sign of going beyond the call of duty, because you don't have to do it. That's what Charlemagne says there. It's not dangerous to doctrine to differ in the way you worship or the way you chant. But nonetheless, the Franks decided to go Roman because it was part of the amicitia, the part of the treaty of friendship and alliance with Rome. Let's now hear another chant from the Christmas Epiphany season, which enfolded the meeting between Pippin and the Pope. This is the introit, Dum Medium Silentium, while a profound silence enveloped all things, and night was in the midst of her course, your all-powerful word, O Lord, came down from the royal throne. Thank you, Graham. Well, you need more than friendship to to create a new repertoire of Frankish-Roman chant for the entire year. You need to be more than friends. So how was the work done? And how did it begin? Well, the musical sources can't really tell us, although they are infinitely suggestive, because they're all too late. Strictly speaking, there are no decipherable traces of genuinely Roman chant, such as we heard in my last lecture, if you were there, until the 11th century, long after the events I've been describing. There's no decipherable record of Gregorian chant, such as that, until the 9th century, which is again too late. The two musical repertoires, Roman and Gregorian, or Frankish-Roman, contain many chants that plainly have a close relationship in melodic terms to one another, and the texts are the same or very similar. So there's obviously a complex interaction, and it's a matter of controversy how it happened. And scholars often have to argue the matter chant by chant. Well, unbelievable as it may seem, it is possible to shine a light on the very beginning of the process before the musical sources were even thought of. We know from various letters that at some time in the 760s, a singer named Simeon was sent from Rome by the Pope, who was now Paul I, to the Cathedral of Rouen on the Seine in Normandy. My guess is that this Simeon was an Easterner, to judge by his name, perhaps a Greek or a Syrian, and God knows what he made of the rain and cold in Rouen, or Frankish beer, for that matter. His task was to teach his hosts the Roman music of psalmody, psalmodii modulatio. Now, this visiting professor of plainsong, if you might call him, came on really very high authority. He was nothing less than the second in command of the Roman choir. And he was eventually, in fact, recalled to take over, to become the first. The choice of Rouen for his work as a teacher was not entirely fortuitous. You see, the bishop there, Remedius, was Pippin's brother, or more strictly speaking, his half-brother. And I make the point again that most major enterprises of the great in this period were in some senses family matters or face-to-face occasions. Well, there was no form, as far as we know, of musical notation then in existence which would allow Simeon to simply write all the melodies out and then go home to his wines and olive oil. There wasn't. And how did they even talk to one another? Simeon certainly didn't speak Frankish, which is, of course, a Germanic tongue, not unrelated to English. And I imagine that he probably spoke either Greek or some other Eastern language, depending where he came from. Did they use Latin to speak to one another? Well, maybe, except at this date, remember we're in the 8th century, Latin means an emerging form of French, and Simeon would certainly not have understood that. So I really don't know how they talk to one another. I don't think anybody knows. I think the question's not often been raised, but they managed to talk to one another somehow. Maybe it made the task of singing the music and listening to it all the more intense because there were no verbal interruptions or explanations. It was very much a matter of out of the throat into the listener's ear. The sounds of the music were held before Frankish ears, so to speak, to produce a human archive of memory, but one that was liable to be constantly influenced by the Franks' own chanting, because they had their own chanting, obviously, and I imagine its habits kept breaking through. And yet this astonishing and in some respects quixotic task of creating a Frankish-Roman hybrid that was distributed throughout the kingdom, or indeed throughout the empire, in a consistent form was achieved. Truly amazing that it should have been so. One of many things in life that if one did not know it were done, one would not believe it could be. If you compare the earliest manuscripts of Gregorian chant, it might be, for example, of the chant you've just heard, from the Alpine monastery of St. Gallen in the south to the cathedral on the bleak cliff of Lens in northern France, a long way off, is to find a remarkable degree of accord between the versions written down, even when the manuscripts themselves, as far as we know, are unrelated. It was achieved. What you are hearing this afternoon is the sound of the medieval Christian West at worship. Well, here and there, we can glimpse the ways in which the melodies were passed from one church to another to secure this truly amazing result. And I'm going to finish with casting a light on one particular person who is well documented. Let's follow his career. He became ultimately the bishop of a cathedral at Le Mans, which has very keen and assiduous chroniclers, so we know a fair bit about him. His name was Aldricus, which is a good Frankish name, and he eventually, as I say, became bishop of Le Mans. Now, cantors or singers had become bishops before, but this was something quite different. The Carolingian sponsorship of Frankish-Roman chant, the creation of it under Carolingian tutelage, had turned those who were expert in its performance into a wonderful reservoir of talent, which was paternalistically nurtured in the royal chapels, notably at Aachen, which of course is Charlemagne's great royal chapel, or in the stalls of Metz Cathedral or at Rouen, so that they might one day become an instrument of royal government by serving as the emperor's man in a strategic see as a bishop. And Le Mans was quite a strategic see. The Carolingians never really managed to implant their power deeply in Brittany, for example, in that great crop of granite of Brittany. And Le Mans was looking out towards Brittany. Well, our man Aldricus was presented to the emperor in 812 when he joined the circle of young men being raised in the imperial household. He was being brought up in the household. They were called the nutriti, those who were being nourished or being brought up. He spent nearly a decade at Aachen, and then he conceived a desire to live the common life of cathedral canons following a quasi-monastic rule. Charlemagne's son, Louis the Pious, who now reigned as emperor, assigned him a place in the stalls at the cathedral of Metz and to the clerics he kept with him, his servants. But the emperor was very keen to discourage our man Aldricus from leaving. My guess, he wanted to make him an imperial chaplain and keep him on hand. A talented man, he could render many services, but this was not to be. Aldricus took up his place at Metz, and for the next 11 years he studied, I quote, Roman chant, grammar, and Holy Scripture. By Roman chant, of course, it means Frankish Roman chant, the ancestor of what you've been hearing tonight. His ascent was swift, as you might expect of a talented man. He became senior cantor and was such a fine teacher of chant that he assumed the title eventually of primiserius scholae, the head of the choir. In 832, Louis the Pious chose him to be his confessor, and in the same year he was consecrated Bishop of Le Mans. Now, at Le Mans, Aldricus set about a building program. He built an aqueduct and a cloister where the canons could live according to rule. He went on to build upper rooms and cellars, and still this was not enough, a contemporary admirer wrote. Still not enough. He built houses, gave the cloister a new roof, and set up more dwellings for the use of brothers. Now, of course, as a former cantor at Metz, and a relative of the emperor, he was in fact a blood relative of the emperor, Aldricus would have wished the reforms of his community to include implantation of the new Frankish-Roman chant. See, that's how it comes. It comes in a complex and very personal stream, as one man comes. And it's part of many other things that he does. He builds, he constructs. And if one can imagine cases like that one, which is fortuitously very well documented, being multiplied throughout the empire, that, I think, is how the great work was done. It was done by singers who were much more than singers, who built new buildings, organized, reformed, and laid, without knowing it, the foundations of our Western musical tradition. Thank you very much.